Hawes-Barton Ropery dates back to the 18th century. Situated on the bank of a small tidal haven, its amazing rope walk was once the longest tiled structure in Europe. The rope walk is a third of a mile long, or as the people who worked here would reckon it, 200 fathoms. Here were made ropes for the Royal Navy in the days of Trafalgar, for the great deep sea fishing fleets of Hull and Grimsby, for the conquest of Mount Everest in 1953, and to tow the oil drilling platforms into the North Sea. Yet it has until recently been a secret treasure, never open to the public. When closure came in 1989, machinery was removed, the doors were closed, and it was left. According to the men and women who worked here, the building retained to a quite astonishing extent the look and the atmosphere that it had, not only in 1989, but stretching back in time. Rope making was a cottage industry for many hundreds of years, but a whole family of ship owners, the Halls, were to take the craft to new heights. They opened their ropery on the south bank of the River Humber in around 1767. A major figure in the development of the works was John Hall, master mariner, merchant ship owner, not to mention adventurer, privateer, and even gunrunner. In a building packed with combustible materials, the danger of fire was never far away, and there were major blazes in 1806 and 1813. Nevertheless, the business survived, developed new techniques of rope making, and as the century wore on and the Humber fishing fleet developed, became increasingly prosperous. The ropery finally passed out of family control in 1890. Two-thirds of the £15,000 capital in the Hawes-Barton Ropery Company Limited now came from trawler owners, bankers, and others. The materials for rope making, hemp, manila, sisal, were brought into the haven by barge and manually hoisted off by the crane, which still stands on the quay. The bales were unpacked by some of the ropery's large workforce of women, who operated in all departments with the exception of the actual rope walks.
No woman worked on the walks at all. It was class too hard, like, because some of the spools was at high. I mean, some of the women aren't very tall, so it's just for the men that.
In fact, even unpacking was a hard, dirty job.
But they split them up, because there was, when they split their bales open, there was like cardboard, really hard. So they had to really bang them. The women who was on it, we had to bang them to get them open.
Materials had to be processed through a series of machines which combed the fibres out before they were ready for spinning. The prepared materials were then sent on to the mill where machines known as gill spinners produced the thread from which ropes were made. The spinning mill was a noisy place which created hearing problems and a surprising solution.
Oh, you had to shout, yeah. And we got into lip reading. A lot of us could lip read, you know, through, well, you had to do, otherwise you didn't know what people were saying.
The loaded bobbins of thread were transferred on barrows to either the rope mill, which made smaller ropes, or the rope walk, where the masterpieces of the rope maker's art were created.
As the machine travelled down pulling the strands, which would be six at a time, that would make two ropes. The chap on the machine would let the machine go past. After a while, he'd get this, put it in to the post there, then separate the strands so that they didn't all twist together in transit going down.
As he went down, the machine boy ensured the strands were kept apart. The link between the top end of the walk and the bottom was effective, albeit rather primitive. At the top end, the strands were cut and attached to hooks. The rope maker then went down the walk to set up the machine down there and to make various adjustments, such as tensioning the strands, before the making of the rope began. As the hooks in the top and bottom end machines turned in opposite directions, forming the rope, a small cart, known as the coach or traveller, was propelled up to the top end.
This is 250 fathom. This is the end of the line. This is as far as that we could draw any strand to make a 200 fathom rope. Not very often that we did come out here, but apart from an American order that we had. But this was, they required 200 fathom coils, finished coils. So this was as far as we could draw. That's the terminology of the strand being drawn out. It's not that we didn't come out in a winter time for these jobs. It was mainly a good weather job was this. Seemed to save it for them good weather jobs. It was cold enough in there without coming out here in the winter as well. Yeah.
The conditions in the rope walk could be primitive. The concrete floor was a very late addition. For most of its existence, the building had a simple, compacted mud floor. Very high tides resulted in the adjacent haven flooding. The surprising solution adopted to solve the problem was to create openings in the walls of the building so that the water could come in one side and go out the other.
Oh yes, I can remember going back to 17-year-old again, where these partitions, they was all wide open, which allowed the haven being at that side of the rope walk, if it ever overflowed, it would allow the water to come through and wash right through into the back field. It was only in the 1975 onwards that these was all bricked up to make it more comfortable working.
The walks was made so that they had windows at the haven side and windows at the other side. And when the tides used to come over the banks, it used to come through one window and out the other one. And sometimes, well, once, we had to go get what we call our stakes. They'd all washed out the windows. We was going out in the field at the other side to get them all back. Well, you couldn't really work. You had to wait while it went down. And then it wasn't very nice.
In the summertime, we used to go through there and have a skive on the bank there.
The danger of fire, which created serious damage on at least two occasions during the rope walk's history, meant that the building was never heated, with the result that it was almost always very cold.
Well, in the winter it was bleak because they couldn't have no heating down there. It would have been too expensive to go the full length of the walks, which was 200 fathoms. So it was nasty, but in the summer it was beautiful. Because when everybody else was hot, you were lovely, just right. People used to want to work there in the summer, but the dreaded winter.
When you went up to the top, you could feel the heat hit you. It was that cold down here, like an ice box, really.
Winter could be spectacular. The roof wasn't felted, and therefore in bad winters, it was possible for the teams arriving for work to find everything buried under a layer of snow. This spectacular picture was snapped by Alf Curtis.
I thought I would get that photograph for a memento just to prove my point maybe sometime that it was a cold hole to work in.
Not that a few inches of snow stopped anything for long.
It didn't stop the works, no. You had to carry on regardless, yes. Nothing stopped for nothing them days. You had to keep going.
In any conditions, a rope works could be a dangerous place to be, and in an age which didn't devote so much time to safety issues, there were mishaps from time to time.
I had an accident, but I went back after the accident because I liked the work that much. I'd wound the bobbins down and the trays out, and I was setting the spools up to get the string off the bobbins. And the machine on the spools wasn't supposed to start till I pressed the knob. And I'd got the string threaded round the spool and the machine started up. And it just ripped my fingers off. I'd run to to find the first aid lady, or the fall woman, and the lady behind my machine, which was my sister-in-law, she come round and found my fingers on the machine. She was in a worse state than I was. I'd lost the three fingers. Yeah, my sister's, not Shirley, but the other one's got a bent finger, and I think my brother's got a bent finger. And my nephew lost his wife. She got killed. She got pulled in by her hair.
Even managers weren't immune, particularly when they were hands-on, as was Donald Hendy.
I mean, once down the walks, he was working on a big rope, and a bar what they put through a top spun round and hit him in the face, and broke his glasses and that. But it didn't stop him coming and helping you. Not many managers would do that.
Throughout its 200-year history, the ropery was one of the major local employers, providing jobs for countless thousands of men and women. There were many memorable characters who worked here, and one of the most important was Donald Hendy, works manager and director, the man in day-to-day charge for almost half a century before his death in 1973.
Considering he was the manager, he lived very frugal. He wouldn't spend a lot of money where he thought it didn't need money. And he had a car that would have been a vintage car. It was one of the big square type. And he used to drive around Barton in it. Yeah. And he would, when bales come in, he would take them off, open them up, and test them and all that, where other managers never did anything like that. I was shocked when my brother told me he'd died. But as I say, most of the top people was invited to take something from his house to remember him by. My brother got a picture with the ships on. I don't know whether it's valuable or whether it's to do with rope works. And he got me a set of scales. They're very old, but very good, very accurate. But I wouldn't get rid of them. My sister-in-law might, but I wouldn't.
The pay at the ropeworks was never spectacular, despite the odd surprise.
Very good. But he got a bit absent-minded because he gave me two rises in 1 week. And when I said to him, I said, well, you gave me a rise on Monday. He said, don't matter, you're worth it. So maybe he wasn't absent-minded.
Rates of pay lagged behind the money being paid by some of the newer industries which were springing up along the Humber Bank. It was a dispute about pay which led to shop steward Betty Goldthorpe walking out.
Oh no, they never wanted to part with money. In fact, that was one of the reasons I left, because we'd asked for this rise and he reckoned there wasn't the money, and the unions had ferreted out that there was plenty of money. They'd got it from sources in London, and I put it to him and he said that if he gave us a rise, the firm would have to close. So I said, well, if we didn't get, I knew there was the money there from other sources. And if I gave him an ultimatum, actually, it was stupid, I know, but I thought it would work. And I gave a month's notice for him to put this rise forward. And he didn't think I would leave. And I left and they got the rise the next week. But having said that, about a year after, they did close. So I don't know who to believe, really. But they got the rise. They got a £10 a week rise. I cut my nose off to spite my face, actually. But I thought, you know, I thought I was doing the right thing.
Nevertheless, the ropery had represented security, and there was real shock when, after takeover in the 1980s, the works finally closed just before Christmas in 1989.
we gathered in the mill, and well, we was told to gather in the mill, and they said that it was going to close within a matter of 8 weeks, and they would try and help us get other jobs, and if we could get other jobs before it closed, all well and good. And they was going to move anybody that wanted to go down to, I believe it was Gateshead, could get a job down there. But it would mean, you know, more or less selling your house and uprooting you completely. And there weren't many went for that. But one firm that did come in, M&M Mouldings, there's quite a few of ex-ropery people work there now. In fact, my son does, and my daughter did. They took quite a few on. Well, there were some radio people come round, and they said, with me being one of the longest serving,